Përshëndetje të nderuar shkuesit, jemi bashkë në vazhdim në këtë intervistë speciale me zyrtarë të lartë të Bashkimit Evropian që kanë qëndruar për këto dy ditë në Kosovë, me cilat për të shpjeguar strategjinë e zgjerimit të Bashkimit Evropian për rajonin duke përfshirë edhe Kosovën. Do të flasim me Christian Danielsson, që është drejtori i përgjithshëm në Komisionin Evropian për negociatat e zgjerimit dhe efiqiencisë dhe zotin Thomas Meyer Harting, që është drejtori menaxhues për Evropë dhe Azi Qendrore në Shërbimin Evropian për punë të jashtme. Gentlemen, thank you very much for talking to KTV.
For sure.
I want to start by asking you, what's the purpose of your visit here and how these meetings have been, Mr. Daniels?
Well, thank you for this, giving us this opportunity. The purpose of our meetings this time has been very much to discuss with our Kosovo partners the Western Balkan strategy that was adopted only 9 days ago. And this is an important strategy. It sets out clearly a perspective, a European perspective, for the whole of the Western Balkans, including Kosovo. A commitment from the EU that the EU door is open. It is also very clear on what needs to be done of the partners here in Western Balkan to move ahead. And that boils down to serious reforms about rule of law, fighting corruption, fighting international organized crime, seeing to that the democratic institution works, electoral reforms, public administration reform, but also economic reforms in order to see to that the economy really delivers, and not least the issue of reconciliation. And the strategy also sets out very clearly the EU's commitment, the Commission's commitment, to support the Western Balkan countries in their efforts. And that boils down to the reforms I outlined, but also issues such as the digital agenda, issues relating to education, issues relating to the socio-economic development, and how one can see to that we can see more positive economic development than what we have seen until now. So it's a very ambitious one, and we have had good meetings with our interlocutors here. My sense is that there is a broad understanding of the importance of this strategy, but now, of course, what will be the big challenge is to see to that it can deliver. And that responsibility is very much on the part of Kosovo, but also, of course, on the part of the EU. So we will work together on doing that.
Mr. Harting, the same question.
I think the strategy for us is a very important step forward, and we believe it's an important step forward for the region. And from our point of view, it is essential that the strategy refers to the entire region, including Kosovo, and has a message for everyone, including Kosovo. And one of the messages, and I'll come back to that, is also on the dialogue.
Now, the Kosovo government, in their reaction after the strategy was published, they feel that the EU doesn't acknowledge fully what Kosovo has done until now. And there's a feeling from some people here that you kind of never mentioned the accession of Kosovo into EU in your strategy, and you talk about the circumstances allowing Kosovo to progress in EU integration. Is it like totally different for Kosovo from other countries?
No, as I said, this is a strategy for the whole of the Western Balkan, and it should be seen as a strategy for the whole of the Western Balkan. What is in there is relevant for Serbia, it's relevant for Bosnia, it's relevant for Kosovo. It's not a strategy where you outline in detail what should be happening with each individual partner in the Western Balkan. That's not the purpose. That is also, I think, how one should see this. So it's an opportunity now for Kosovo to use this strategy in order to move ahead on its EU path. And as I said, strong support from our side in doing exactly that.
And the road, the end is like accession to EU?
And end is that the EU door is open.
As I said.
For Kosovo, just like for any
for
other all, country
for the Western
in
Balkan,
Western Balkans.
For the Western Balkans.
What does Kosovo has to do until, I mean, the SAA is just the first step, right? So Kosovo is in the step one of this EU accession road.
I think the important thing now for Kosovo is to exactly focus on what needs to be done step by step. And the Stabilization Association Agreement is essential. It entered into force only 1.5 years ago, and now it needs to be seen to that one is fully exploited. There is the important European reform agenda, which sets out in quite some details, I think 22 measures, that Kosovo has committed to do in a timeline which runs until the end of this year, if I remember it rightly. And now our strong advice to the government here and to the parliament and also to everybody else who are in this process is to focus into seeing to that those measures are being put into place. That is about fighting corruption. That is about public administration reform. But that is also about the reform of the economy. And that is also looking into other elements of seeing to that the Kosovo society becomes more efficient and comes closer towards the standards of the European Union.
What would be the next step after this agenda is fulfilled?
Well, we will continue to work on the various elements that are necessary in order for Kosovo to move forward on its EU path. And that means to go through on the individual areas, be it in the economy, be it in the terms of standardization, be it in the terms of rule of law, as I mentioned, that everything comes with it. That is the next step, and that is going to take some time because it's quite a bold and ambitious agenda that needs to be fulfilled.
Kosovo wants to apply to be a candidate member. Is that like a far?
I don't think one should focus on those kind of steps now. Now focus should be, and that is also what the strategy points to, now focus should be on the concrete issues that needs to be addressed in order to move forward on the EU path. And that is the reforms that I mentioned. And that is going to be substantial, and that's going to be, I think, sufficient to focus both minds and ambitions and clear determination in order to see that happen.
Do you have a consensus within the EU about this strategy enlargement policy for the whole region? Because we've seen reports of Spain trying to block Kosovo's path towards EU.
No, I mean, this is not an issue too. The issue is that we have on the table now a strategy for the Western Balkan. And that is
which was agreed by all the countries.
Which the Commission has presented.
And everyone is on board.
Which the Commission has presented, and that will now be discussed in the Council, and we'll see what the Council will have for conclusions in June. But that is a strategy which is on the table, and that is what we're going to work on the basis of.
And about the time frames, you've set to 2025 as a possible date for Serbia's accession and Montenegro's accession.
No, I think that's a misunderstanding. The 2025 is a reference. It is very ambitious. It is not the target date. But it is a reference that is in the strategy. It should not seem as a target date for any country. The reference, we hope, is going to work as a motivation for the Western Balkan as a whole.
What does Serbia has to do before it accesses to you?
It needs, any country needs to do what any country needs to do, which is to see to that it lives up to all the conditions that are called for in order for the country to become a member of the European Union. But in addition to that, and I think Thomas is better seated than me to comment on it, there is the issue of the dialogue between Belgrade and Pristina, which also needs to come to a successful result.
First of all, let me say that Thessaloniki, as you know, said, and I think one has to revert to that, that the future of the entire Western Balkans lies in the European Union. At the time of Thessaloniki, Kosovo was not present. We will discuss the future of the region again in a format in Sofia, which will include representatives of Kosovo. So I think this is an important development that is fundamentally of interest to you. That's the first point. The second point is that the strategy, which Director General Danielson referred to in some detail, is also very clear on the dialogue. It is very clear that both sides need to work and achieve full comprehensive normalization of their relations, that there has to be a legally binding agreement on this, and that this needs to be implemented for both to make progress on the European path. And I think it is important to stress the point, this is an obligation both for Serbia and for Kosovo, and for both of them to make movement forwards respectively. And what the final outcome of this process, this dialogue of normalization is very much a process between the two sides. The European Union, High Representative Mogherini, facilitates this process, but the parties have to come to an agreement. An agreement means what it means, that both sides have to agree to the outcome. Belgrade has to agree to the outcome, and Pristina has to agree to that outcome. We believe, as you know, in general in our relations with partners, in the principle of ownership. It is for the It is for our partners to define their goals, and we facilitate and help in this process.
But will you propose the outcome as a mediator? Who will propose the outcome? Both parties have to agree.
I think the important point is we don't see our role as mediators, we see our role as facilitators. That is precisely the role that the High Representative plays, and which she considers extremely important, which is one of her priorities. She's been very clear also for the remainder of her mandate. We have already in this process achieved a number of important agreements. Quite a number of these agreements still need to be implemented, so there has to be a focus on the implementation of this agreement, but at the same time we have to work for full and comprehensive normalization. And I can only repeat what I said. The meaning of full and comprehensive normalization has first of all to be defined by the parties in this process, in agreement between both parties, and then of course the member states of the European Union, all 27 I suppose at that point in time, will have to accept that full normalization has been achieved.
Will this legal binding agreement means that Serbia cannot block Kosovo's path towards the EU?
I think, and Director General Danielson can refer to this in greater detail, even beyond the Kosovo-Serbia relationship. It is a general principle of the strategy that no one who joins the European Union from the region should block the access of others.
Mr. Danielson?
Well, that's correct.
That's the case.
It's very clear. It's very clear.
We need to see. I think the wording is that there needs to be irrevocable binding provisions that sees to that exactly what you outline, namely that countries that join the European Union cannot block others who are on the way joining.
And they cannot have open issues, can they?
No, that is very, very clear. On the open issues, the strategy, there's no way that the European Union will import, for instance, issues about border issues into the EU. So the message of the strategy here is adamantly clear. That needs to be solved before, bilaterally, and if not bilaterally, to find it through arbitration, and that should be followed, and arbitration that should be followed as well. And I think that's very, very important.
When will the dialogue continue? Is it going to be high level between presidents of Kosovo and Serbia? And can you see others being involved? Because we have a request from Kosovo for USA to be involved in the dialogue.
First of all, there are various levels of this dialogue. There is the level of implementing what has already been agreed. And there, of course, the chief negotiators, in our opinion, should meet as soon as possible to discuss the implementation of what has already been agreed. And I think that the High Representative has already expressed her willingness to have a meeting also at the leaders level to take this process forward at the political level.
And what about other parties being involved?
Well, I think it is essential from our point of view that this is a process that is facilitated by the European Union, and a process facilitated by the European Union between these two parties. That is the format which has made it possible to achieve the successes we have achieved so far, and that is the format with which we want to continue to work.
You're saying that there is no need for others to be involved?
We are in constant contact with others, but the process is a process facilitated by the European Union between these two parties. And that's the way we can achieve success.
The most talked issue in those 2 years in Kosovo is, not 2 years, like for a decade, the visa liberalization, Kosovo being the only isolated country in Europe. And we know it comes to the border agreement with Montenegro. Talking to Kosovo leaders, do you get a sense that are going in the near future to fulfill this obligation?
Very much hope so. My impression is that it's well known by everybody how important this issue is. It's well set out. There needs to be a ratification of the demarcation agreement. And we hope that the leaders here will find a way to move forward on that. But you should not forget, we need not forget, that there is also another condition that needs to be also fulfilled, and we are following that very closely, and that is the issue of corruption. There are clear benchmarks, and we are going to look into that very, very carefully, and so far it's going in the right direction, but it's a continuous struggle and it's a continuous efforts that needs to be done in that respect. It is essential, because as you know, corruption is something that is not only negatively affecting the citizens of this country. Corruption is also something that infects the political system,
And it's something which has very negative effects when it comes to economic development, not least when it comes to investments and investments from abroad.
So it's not fulfilled, the corruption condition is not yet fulfilled.
It's something that we are following very closely, and once we are at the point when we can go forward and say that now it's fulfilled, we will do that.
Because there is a sense here that once the demarcation is approved in the Assembly, we can have the visa liberalization.
No, I mean, in parallel, this the corruption issue needs also to be fulfilled, and so far it's not fulfilled.
And do you think that this year is the one that we can get the visa liberalization?
I wouldn't like to speculate about that. I would like to wait until I can see that the two conditions are fulfilled, and what I can see today is that none of them are.
None of them are. Okay, I want to talk about the EU's role for rule of law in Kosovo with your mission. Actually, ULEX runs its mission in this June. What will happen next, and how do you evaluate the role of EU for rule of law in Kosovo?
I think that, first of all, making progress on the rule of law is essential for Kosovo itself. Progressing in the field of democracy, human rights, rule of law is essential for every one of our partners in the Western Balkans, and in a certain sense it's the key message of the strategy. The strategy basically says that the future of our partners lies in the European Union, but not in the situation in which they find themselves today. So obviously this is an essential development, and it is also clear that the European Union can be supportive in this context. Our mission has been supportive in the past, and I think it will continue to be supportive in an advisory function.
When we are talking about the rule of law, you know that there's been an attempt by the Kosovo Assembly to abolish the specialist chambers. Talking to Kosovo leaders, do you get the sense that they forgot that they're over it? Because, I mean, the initiative is still in the Assembly.
Well, first of all, let me say that this is an international obligation that Kosovo took upon itself in 2014. And if we're speaking about the future of Kosovo in the region and the future relations of Kosovo with us, the first starting point is that we have to be sure that Kosovo respects the international obligations it has already assumed. So there can be no question for us that these obligations continue to bind Kosovo, and therefore we were, as you can imagine, quite disturbed by some of the developments we see in the Assembly. We understand and we hope that this matter will not be taken up again in the Assembly, and I can only hope that this is true, because this is essential for the future of our relationship.
What would it mean for Kosovo, Mr. Danielson, if it would abolish the special court? Would it mean for Kosovo if it would abolish the special court?
I think Thomas replied to the question.
I think the point is not...
No, but we have no separate opinions here. Okay. I think Thomas replied very clearly to the question that this is an international agreement.
I don't think there's a question of abolishing the courts. The courts were established by this agreement and the courts will function. The essential point is whether Kosovo continues to cooperate in the frame with the work of these courts on the basis of the agreements it has assumed.
During your visit here, you've talked about economic development as well, which is obviously very important, and there's been an agreement about the railways. Can you explain what it is about and how important it will be for Kosovo?
No, it is very important. It's part and parcel of the broader connectivity agenda of the Western Balkan. It is one of the so-called corridors that now is going to be upgraded, and it is the one that is going to go north-south through Kosovo, down the whole way to Thessaloniki and to Bulgaria. And what we did today was to sign off the agreement as regards the part which is south of Pristina towards the border of Macedonia. And that will create once it's in place, it will make it easier for people to travel, but it will also be very important from an economical point of view. It will create the possibility of transport much more efficient than was the case today. And we're talking of a fairly big investment. So it's a grant from the EU, from the Commission of 30, or from European taxpayers, of 38.5 million euros, which in itself then mobilize, I think, something like 80 million through loans for the EBRD, the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development.
This one will then continue to develop the project as such. And I think the total envelope of the whole project is something like 200 million for the upgrading of this railway corridor.
Are we talking about the time frame?
Oh, there you got me. I don't know the exact time frame, okay. But I presume that it's something which will be worked on as fast as possible. But all this kind of work takes time, as you know.
And EU will also help about a highway, building a highway from Pristina to Nis.
We are doing that. We are helping with that one. And we are involved also in other infrastructure investment here in Kosovo and beyond. All of that is part of this broader engagement from the EU side of, if you want figures, it's 1 billion euro, which is invested and is going to, I think, continue in and become even bigger as the years in the years ahead. What is going to be important here is that one thing is the commitment that we are doing from our side. It needs then to be followed by diligent work by each individual country in order to see to that the project actually takes place. And so far, I must say, with the here in Kosovo, that we have seen a strong determination from the government and from other authorities to work on these projects.
And also in light of the SAA implementation, what other economic reforms should Kosovo do?
Well, I think there is the broader issue of the economy as such. On the macroeconomic side, Kosovo is doing quite well. If you look on issues like public debt and issues relating to budget deficits and so on and so forth. But of course, if you look on the growth level, there is room for a substantive increase of the growth or level of Kosovo. And what are the issues that needs to be addressed? Well, we have discussed one. Issue of corruption needs to be addressed. It's essential. And rule of law, when it comes to the functioning of the judiciary, is also essential. Actors in the economy needs to know that they can get their rights respected through the legal system. But in addition to that, the whole issue of the informal economy needs to be addressed. That one is taking away important tax revenues, but it's also by itself informal and therefore providing for a non-competitive environment for those who are in the formal economy. So it needs to be addressed, that one. And then it's the whole issue of business environment, where Kosovo has done quite well over the last couple of years, but there is still room for improvement. You have seen on the World Bank data. That also needs to be addressed. And then we have issues such as the SME financing. There is the issue of training, and in particular vocational training that needs to be looked into. And there is the issue of the education system. So it's a broad area of measures that our strong advice is for the government and for Kosovo to look into. And this is part and parcel also of the economic reform agenda. So there you will find many of these elements.
I want to talk about the environment as well. And we have a lot of problems with air pollution, especially here in the capital city of Pristina. How can EU help or advise maybe about the measures we can work on?
I can imagine here in Pristina an issue of concern of many. One concrete such measure is to see to that what comes out of the important power plant just outside Pristina, emission control measures on it, and thereby get down the emissions which are both unhealthy and I think of concern of many. And here we are working together. So we are moving forward with a fairly ambitious program in addressing that for what is called the B plant. And total amount is 35 million. It boils down to getting filters on top of the chimneys so that what comes out of the power plant is cleaned up. And then I think there is the general issue of the infrastructure when it comes to the various issues relating to air pollution. Everything from the heating in houses here, and I imagine also to look into the standards of the cars and the emission that they are letting out, and so on and so forth. And all of these issues are in fact partly linked to the EU agenda, because such standards, when it comes to cars, is part and parcel of what is called of by any country who would like to join the European Union.
And if I can just come back to the visa liberalization issue once again, the condition is seen in Kosovo as unjust to have the border demarcation approved. And everyone said that it wasn't set for other countries in the region.
Well, that's not the right approach, in my view, to look into this. Each country has had its individual visa roadmap. This was individual for Georgia, it was individual for Ukraine, it was individual for the other neighbors to Kosovo.
Ukraine didn't have the in West territory issue.
All of them had individual roadmaps. Now, that roadmap was agreed between the country and the EU. And that was the case with Kosovo. So that was what we looked into in 2012 or 13, and that is now what we're working on the basis of. So it's not a question of being unjust. It's a question of seeing to that the roadmap that we have agreed together is being fulfilled. And our commitment on our side, the Commission side, is that once that roadmap is fulfilled, we will not shy away from going forward with the recommendation which is necessary in order for member states to take the decision.
And you think that the Assembly has no reason to push it and it should just ratify the agreement?
That's exactly what they should do.
And now we will have soon a visit, right, by, let's say, the big bosses, Mr. Juncker and Madame Mogherini in the region as well, Kosovo as well, right? Is it like a sign of the commitment of the EU towards these countries?
Very much so. I think this is the first visit of President Juncker. Not only the President, but also, as you mentioned, the High Representative Vice President Mogherini and Commissioner Hahn. And it's a sign of the importance that is attached from the EU to the Western Balkan. And it's also a sign of the commitment from the Commission and from the High Representative in terms of going for moving forward on this agenda. So I think it's very, very important.
I mean, as I think I already said earlier on, one of the most important messages of the strategy is precisely that it's a message for the entire region, for all six Western Balkans partners. And therefore it is, I think, also an important sign that the President is visiting all six Western Balkans partners. And obviously, High Representative Mogherini has many reasons to be particularly interested in the relationship with Kosovo.
And thank you very much for talking to KTV.
Thanks a lot.